Becky. Welcome back to my channel. I have another homeschooling video for you guys today. If you like homeschooling videos, make sure you give this one a thumbs up. Today we're going to be talking about transitioning from public school to homeschool, and then I'm also going to be giving you guys my best homeschooling advice for new homeschoolers. So if you want to see that, then stay tuned. Okay, so if you don't know the backstory, my oldest daughter, who is in 10th grade now, but she was in the middle of 4th grade when we decided to pull her out of public school. She had public schooled from kindergarten all the way through the middle of 4th grade. And we had already decided to go ahead and homeschool 5th grade and on, but things were getting so crazy at her school, I just decided to go ahead and pull her out early. We pulled her out in the middle of 4th grade, and I had nothing prepared. I knew nothing. I knew how to do nothing. I had no curriculum purchased. I didn't know what to do and how to do it, and I just kind of started one day. It was like, we gotta figure this out, and boom, we did it. Now, obviously, things have gotten better over the years. I know a little bit more about what I'm doing, but that was a very scary, like, half of the year, trying to figure out what can I do with her to finish out 4th grade and then going forward. But pulling her out of public school mid-year and then starting to homeschool her was a very big change for her, and it was a very big change for me. And there were several things that I feel like I did that really helped to ease that transition, and I'm going to share those with you guys, and I'm going to talk about at the end kind of my best homeschooling advice for new homeschoolers, things that I've learned over the years, mistakes that I've made when I first started homeschooling that I have learned from, that I feel like anybody that's new to homeschooling or even thinking about it might be helpful for them to hear. So the first thing I think can help, no matter what your reasons are for pulling your kids out of public school and homeschooling them, is get your kids excited. My oldest really was not sure how she felt about it when I told her that we were gonna take her out of public school and start homeschooling her. She was really kind of confused, like, how does that work? What's gonna happen? What am I gonna do all day? What about my friends? I think it really helped because she was excited to see all the different curriculum options out there, because when you homeschool, you don't have to do what the teacher and the school gives you. You can go out and pick and choose every single curriculum that you want for each subject. And I think that really excited her, and it really excited me. So I would go through and kind of pick out several things that I thought would be a good fit for her. And I would let her look at it with me and say, okay, what do you think about this one? Or would you like to do this one or this one? And they were all things that I had already kind of narrowed down. So no matter what she chose, I don't think it was a bad decision, because I had already weeded out a lot of the ones that I knew we didn't want to use. So that really helped her to give her some control over what she was going to be learning, and some excitement about, you know, I'm actually getting involved and being able to pick out what I'm going to do in school each day. And that really helped her. I also did a lot of unit studies with her, especially to finish out 4th grade, because I didn't have a science curriculum, I didn't have anything, so we did a lot of unit studies about birds and different types of animals, because those were things that she was interested in, that she was really excited to do, that would count for science, and there was some writing involved and some reading involved and some research involved, so she was still learning, but it was really, really fun and interesting for her, and that got her really excited about the possibilities that in homeschool a lot of times you can have a say-so in what you learn and when you learn it. So find things to get your kids excited about homeschooling, and even to this day I still point out to them, you know, when we go out for lunch and we pass a school and the kids are still in school, or, you know, something like that, or we're out of school going to Disney and there's kids still in school, I am not too proud to say, hey, you know, this is another benefit of homeschooling. You know, we get to go out to lunch every day. We get to run errands and come back and do school later. We can go on vacations when everybody else is doing school because we didn't take unnecessary holidays and snow days and things like that. We got our school done and we get to go on vacation now. And so there's so many benefits you can point out: sleeping in, doing school in your pajamas, having a class pet, or doing your school by the Christmas tree or with the dog in your lap, you know, all different fun things you can do with homeschooling that you can't do in public school. Another thing I really did, especially in the beginning, to try to ease the transition from public school to homeschool was to help my daughter have opportunities to see her friends from public school. Of course, also other kids their age, but there may be some kids in particular from public school they may be missing. So one thing I did was, a couple months after we started homeschooling, I had a surprise party for her, for her best school friends. And I had them all come to the house and I had things decorated and they came over and she was so surprised and she loved seeing them that way. Make sure you get their contact information so they can still communicate through text or email or, you know, FaceTime or something like that. But you don't want them to feel like they're never going to see their friends from school again. I think sometimes as time goes on, some of those friendships will fall off on their own. Maybe they won't, but maybe they will. But in the meantime, you are giving them an opportunity to still see and talk to their friends when you can. So they don't feel like they're just leaving everybody behind. Like I said, even if it's not kids that they knew from school, when you start homeschooling them, it is important to make sure they do have activities and things to do and places to go with kids their age. That is important. And there's so many ways to do that. You can do it through a homeschool co-op. They can take lessons. They can go to different activities at the library or a church. There's so many ways to get kids involved with other kids their age, to give them that social aspect and to make new friends that doesn't involve a public school at all. And both of my girls' best friends are people they've met skating or at church. So, and a co-op. So, I mean, there's all these different places they're meeting people and spending time with kids their age, which is really important. You're just choosing who you spend that time with and when you spend that time with them. And my next tip for transitioning from public school to homeschool, but really this one kind of works along the way. This really works pretty much for any part of the homeschooling journey, is having a dedicated space for your child to do homeschool and make it as fun and personalized as you can. When you're in public school, unless you have a really fun public school where you're allowed to pick your own supplies, my oldest didn't. She had to have a blue folder, a yellow folder, a pink folder, one box of this. You couldn't have a fun pencil case. You couldn't do this. You know, there were so many rules about what they had to have and what they couldn't have. So when you homeschool, you can have as many puppy folders as you want. You can use colored pens, you can use, you know, scented markers, you can do all these things, you can have a cute pencil case. You don't have to have these rules about what you can and can't have, and I think that's really fun. So maybe you take your kid out of school and you take them school supply shopping and you say, you know, you can buy whatever pens or whatever markers or whatever pencil case that you want, or even a book bag to keep their supplies in. Any of these things they can do to make it fun that they couldn't have done in public school. And whether they have a designated desk to do their work at, or they're doing their work at the kitchen table or wherever, you know, working in their room, make it fun for them. We have a homeschool room, which at the time we first started homeschooling, both girls were in there. Now that my oldest is in 10th grade and my youngest is in 4th grade, my oldest has her own desk upstairs in the playroom. She organizes it how she wants, and I just decorated it for her for Christmas. But she has her own supplies, her own space that she's able to go and work. My youngest still works downstairs in the homeschool room with me. She has her own desk, she has her own supplies, and she's got her own little setup. And they can work around the house wherever they want. They don't have to stay at their desks, but I feel like it helps them to know that they have a place where their books are, their supplies are, they know where to go when they need something, and to make it fun along the way with all the fun little school supplies and things like that. So I think that really does help whether you are new to homeschooling or you're taking a child out of public school and you're trying to make it more fun to homeschool. I think that really helps. Okay, the next stuff I want to talk about with you guys is my best homeschooling advice for new homeschoolers. So my first thing is, don't feel bad, disappointed, or discouraged if homeschooling is not as easy slash fun slash enjoyable as you thought it would be. You know, you see the homeschooling curriculum catalogs, and there's always parents and their kids laughing, and things look so easy, and the mom's hair is always nice, and there's not a mess in the kitchen and a big pile of laundry to be folded while you're trying to teach your kids science. You know, they don't show that part of homeschooling. Sometimes homeschooling is really hard. Sometimes you feel like you can't handle all of your homeschooling responsibilities and your responsibilities as a mom, staying at home, taking care of the house, cooking dinner, taking care of other kids who may not be homeschooling. Sometimes you get annoyed because you teach your child something over and over and over and they still don't get it. Sometimes you think there's something wrong with the way you're teaching. Sometimes you think there's something wrong with your kid. They don't understand it. Why don't they get it? You worry that you're not patient or smart enough to do it. And you wonder if it's really worth it at the end of the day after pulling your hair out over picking a curriculum or something that didn't work, or your kid not grasping a concept, or them fighting the whole time, or all of these different things that can happen. Sometimes you think, why am I doing this? Why am I putting myself through this? That's why it's really important to know why you're homeschooling in the first place. Write it down somewhere if you need to. Have a little list of why you're homeschooling, why you started homeschooling in the first place. And every time you have those bad days, which you're gonna have, go back and look at that list. But when you're confident in why you're homeschooling, the hard days don't seem so bad. They may still stink sometimes, but I think it's one of those things that once you've wrapped your brain and your confidence around the fact why you do it, and you're positive that it's the right decision, the hard days aren't as bad because you realize it's just something you have to work through, and the next day hopefully will be better. But that's why you really have to sit down and do it, you know, a heart to heart with yourself and your spouse and say, why are we doing this? Why am I making my life harder? Because you are, essentially, to homeschool. I mean, there's so many benefits that outweigh the difficulty of it, but still, you're not making your life easier by homeschooling. Nobody ever made their life easier by taking their kids and trying to teach them themselves and grade and have the stress of trying to make sure you're setting them up for success and you're teaching them what they need to know and you're doing all these things. Nobody ever did that because it was the easy route. But knowing why you're doing it makes the struggles and the day-to-day difficulties a lot easier. My second tip is don't be discouraged if your kids don't like it. So you do your best, you know, you maybe take some of the other tips that I gave you earlier into consideration. You do your best to make it fun for them. But again, at the end of the day, if you know your why and you know why you're homeschooling them, they're children. And it's not up to them to understand maybe why you're making the decision that you're making. All you can do is hope and pray for them that they will understand and appreciate at some point, hopefully sooner than later, what you're doing and why you're doing it. My next advice for new homeschoolers is try to accept the fact that there is a learning curve for homeschooling. There's a learning curve for you and there's a learning curve for your child. They have to get used to you as their teacher, their principal, their guidance counselor, all that stuff. And you have to get to them, used to them as a student, how they learn, where they may be behind, where they may be ahead. You are basically figuring out your child as far as their education pretty much for the first time. I mean, because if they were in public school, you may have seen some worksheets come back and maybe some tests come back, but you weren't aware of what it took to get your child to that point or where they were struggling or how they learned best. So there definitely is a learning curve to figure that out for each child. And you really have to get that balance between mom mode and teacher mode. And it's definitely a hard balance sometimes, but when I'm teaching my youngest daughter at this point now, but at that time it was my oldest, I really have to be a little bit more authoritative than I would be maybe if I was just mom. I'm really having to make sure, you know, try to keep them focused, try to keep them quiet, try to keep them on task, try to make sure I'm not coddling them as their mom, because as their teacher, I'm not doing them any favors. You really do have to strike that balance between teacher mode and mom mode, because there is a balance to be had between knowing your child and knowing how they respond, knowing when they've had too much or are overwhelmed and need a break or if they're sick, but then also teacher mode, where you have to make sure that you're requiring enough of them, asking enough of them, and expecting enough of them. And there is a balance there that you have to find with each kid, because each kid is different. So that is definitely going to take some time. So don't be discouraged if it takes a while to figure that out, or if it takes your child a while to figure that out. And there are definitely systems you can put in place. Like, one thing we had a hard time with in the beginning was they weren't turning in their work at the end of the day. They were just leaving it on their desk or upstairs or in the playroom. And I'm like, how am I supposed to grade your work if I don't even have it? So we made that one of their daily expectations. And it's one of the ways they can earn a Loki buck, which Loki's our dog. And we have a homeschool reward system where they earn Loki bucks for doing different things. They're usually things that I want to encourage as a habit, like turning in your work at the end of the day. There's a little grading cubby on my desk. They know where to put the work. And if they would turn the work in at the end of each school day, they would get a Loki buck. There's a couple other things they can do to earn Loki bucks, but that really helped establish that habit. So now it hardly ever happens where somebody has work somewhere else and not in the grading box. So giving yourself grace to realize that you're their mom, but you're also their teacher, and giving your child grace to realize that they're not just your child anymore, they're also your student. There is definitely some time involved to figure that out for you and for your kids. So definitely be patient and realize that is kind of part of it. It's the growing pains of homeschooling, and you will get to a point where that gets easier, but in the beginning it may be a little bit of a challenge. My next piece of advice, and this is a big one, and when I think back about my homeschooling mistakes previously, one of the biggest ones I can think of is don't expect your homeschool day to take as long as a public school day would have taken. When my oldest daughter was in elementary school, she was gone for about 6.5 hours, and I thought, so when we started homeschooling, I thought, okay, I've got to get 6 hours of school in. She's got to do 6 hours of work every day. And I literally had that poor child punching a time chart. Like, I had a little chart written out, and she would write down what time she started doing work, and then she'd stop, right? What time she stopped. And then she went to, on lunch, and she'd come back and check back in. And I was adding up her minutes and totaling it all up and making her punch a time card. Seriously, it was crazy. And it was so stressful for her. It was so stressful for me. And then I realized over the course of time, that's not necessary. Unless they're in maybe middle school, maybe even high school, there's no reason why they should be taking, 5, 6, 7 hours to do their schoolwork. Now that she's in high school, some of her classes do take longer, or she might do a little bit more extra because she's got a writing assignment or something, but for the most part, it doesn't take that long. You don't have all these unnecessary breaks and interruptions that you're going to have in public school. You don't have a reading group with one group of the kids and the other kids just kind of sit there twiddling their thumbs waiting for their turn to be with the teacher. You don't have all these breaks and things that come up in public school. You have that time where you're sitting down, you're working, you're getting your stuff done, It doesn't have to take 6 hours, and you definitely shouldn't try to make it take 6 hours because you feel like that's what they're doing in public school. My next tip, and I've talked about this before, don't be afraid to switch curriculum. I used to try to make curriculum work because either I spent a lot of money on it, or I knew people that used it and loved it, or I saw a review about it and someone was raving about it, or it was really popular, or I spent so much time researching it and I was so excited about it, and then now I hate it, so I'm like, I can't stop using it now because I spent all this time and money and thought and effort into purchasing it, that we really must make ourselves use it. But everybody is different. Every child is different, and you learn as you go that sometimes something worked in the beginning and it stops working. Sometimes something doesn't work from the very beginning and you know you hate it instantly. Your child changes, and maybe they don't like the same type of curriculum that they used to. Maybe they don't want as many cut and paste hands-on activities. They want to do a lot more reading, or maybe they enjoy doing things on the computer. You know, there's reasons why you would have to change your curriculum, all different reasons why. So don't be afraid to change them. It may not work out, and it's okay. And I think at the end of the day, once you realize that and you give yourself permission to change it up, it's a lot more relaxing and a lot more freeing and a lot less stressful when you don't have to sit there and think, well, I spent $150 on this. We have to do this every day, even though we hate it. Know the company's return policy. Have some options for places that you can sell it. Maybe there's a homeschool co-op that you go to where you can sell things to other parents. Or maybe there's a eBay, I know, is a place that I have sold some things before, and I've bought some things before from there. There's all different places and ways you can sell used curriculum. But the main thing I would do first is check the company's return policy. Some companies have a very generous return policy. I know All About Reading has a really generous one. I think it's a year. A lot of these things hold their value really well. Obviously, if you've written in it, it's not going to, but if it's a textbook or some type of disc, a lot of times they hold their value really well. I have sold all of my youngest daughter's All About Reading curriculum for a very high price, pretty close to what I paid for it new. And sometimes in life, you just have to cut your losses and kind of get yourself okay with that. And that's the same thing with homeschool curriculum. Just because you bought something and it works for someone you know, or you saw a good review about it from me or anybody else, if it's not working for you or your kids, then let it go and try something else that will work for you and your kids. So those are my tips for transitioning from public school to homeschool, and then also my best homeschooling advice for new homeschoolers. I really, really hope it was helpful. If you guys homeschool and you want to share any tips in the comments of what you do, either you took your kids out of public school and you wanted to make it a good transition to homeschool, or if you have any advice you want to share with me and everyone else that reads the comments about homeschooling, I would really appreciate it if you would leave it in the comments, because that's really how we help each other. You know, I can talk all day long, but I want to hear from you guys too, what your best homeschooling advice is. So that would be really helpful to me and to everyone else, I'm sure. If you're interested in seeing any of my other homeschooling videos, I have an entire homeschool playlist where every homeschooling video I've ever made is in that playlist. There's tons of them, and I'll link that for you also. And make sure if you like this video and it was helpful that you give it a thumbs up, and please share it with anyone that may be considering homeschooling, or they already are homeschooling but they're struggling. Definitely share this video with them. It may be helpful to them. I would really appreciate it, and I'm sure they would too. Thank you guys so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.